Imagine this. You are crawling through a narrow tunnel beneath the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. The air is thick with dust, and the sound of shovels and clattering carts echoes around you. It is so incredibly hot that your respirator becomes useless and you just put it down. And yet you keep digging, loading and running. This is a story of one of the most complex mining operations in history. It was early May 1986, less than a week after the Chernobyl disaster. As rumors began to spread, a secure call was made from the governmental task force in Chernobyl city. That call reached an office 80 miles away in Kyiv, the headquarters of KyivMetroBud, the subway construction company known for its expertise in deep, complex underground construction. The head, Oleksiy Semenov, listened intently, realizing the task they received was unlike anything they had done before. The caller explained, thousands of tons of materials had been dropped from helicopters into the destroyed Reactor 4 in a desperate bid to stop the fire. And yet, no one truly understood what exactly was happening inside. So there was a growing fear that the reactor core might overheat, melt, and eventually collapse under this immense weight. And even more terrifying, if the molten core reached the water horizon fed by Pripyat River, contamination would spread to Dnieper and then to Black Sea, effectively poisoning the entire country. Or, in the worst-case scenario, trigger an explosion of a scale never seen before. After a brief pause, the caller continued. They needed to create the pit near Unit 3. The radiation levels were significantly lower. From this pit, a series of long horizontal drills would reach an area beneath Unit 4. There, an immense amount of liquid nitrogen would be pumped in to create a deep freeze, stabilizing the sand and cooling the reactor from below. KyivMetroBud was the only team capable of the task, and this is why. If you have ever been to Kyiv, you know that while the subway system here isn't large, it was built mostly exceptionally deep. And actually, for 62 years, the Arsenalna metro station on the M1 line held a world record for depth. Kyiv's subway stations are deep not only because of complex terrain, but also due to challenging geology with underground rivers and rift sands. And so, nitrogen freezing was a technique KyivMetroBud very frequently used. We found a few first-hand accounts that shed light on what happened next. One of them comes from Sergei Lichman, one of the top engineers of KyivMetroBud. Me and two senior engineers left to the zone right from Semenov's office on May 5. When we reached the Chernobyl City Council, we felt the tension in the air. Crowds shuffled between offices, guided by a very tired secretary. It took us some time to find a place to sleep, and we eventually ended up in the camp in Rudnya Veresnya, a village about 6 miles away. Later that night, our machines and colleagues arrived, along with the head of KyivMetroBud, Semenov. At 5 a.m. he briefed us and updated our task. Since the groundwater level was unknown, first we had to drill the watering wells, and only then begin the main operation. And now imagine this, the pit site was well shielded by the massive Unit 3, but to reach it we had to travel in the armored vehicle past the damaged reactor. Radiation there sometimes reached 1500 rangens per hour. And once we passed that, we started to outline the work area. We found some scattered black fragments of asphalt, which we used to draw marks on the walls. And shockingly, later we discovered, these weren't asphalt pieces at all. They were reactor graphite. You have to understand, it was not just about digging some sort of hole. It had to be done in such a way that the giant structure above won't collapse. Compressors, cables, pipes and food lights were delivered, people arrived on APCs and we began drilling. At depths up to 11 meters, no water was found, meaning we could continue digging without any dewatering. But on May 9, we encountered the foundations of the cranes that once built the power plant. That was a problem, because those were very huge blocks of concrete no crane could lift. Then, Minister of Transport Construction Volodymyr Brezhnev managed to bring us a Japanese Komatsu bulldozer. At the same moment the remotely controlled bulldozer was cleaning those blocks, George Kalinichenko was in a car approaching the disaster zone. I remember it was a bright, sunny day. Everything was in bloom, and yet we didn't see a single vehicle driving from the zone. Then started deserted villages. Some houses had boarded up windows. Well, I cannot explain it. All looked normal, but empty, and that made it feel completely eerie. We came to camp in Rudnya Veresne, picked our engineers and went to work immediately. A few miles past the city of Chernobyl, a gigantic chimney of the power plant emerged on the horizon. We stopped at a checkpoint where they were issued individual dosimeters and told to continue in a small APC, as it was too dangerous to travel by car. And packed like sardines in a can, me, Semenov and a few top engineers, we headed to the power plant's administrative building. I immediately noticed that famous propaganda slogan over it, Chernobyl nuclear power plant works for communism. It was bitterly ironic. We then transferred to a larger APC and rode to the pit, and through the visors I saw the horrifying image of destroyed Unit 4. In the pit, we immediately began planning the horizontal drilling for freezing operation, where and how to position equipment. That was not easy, and I had to spend 3 endless hours at the pit, where radiation was around 6 rangens per hour. Next day we set up a drilling machine and began our first horizontal drill. It worked well, until on May 16 Semenov suddenly ordered us to stop, pack our stuff up and return to Kyiv, because as he said, there were some changes. So what exactly happened? At that time, scientists of Kurchatov Nuclear Institute calculated that thermal processes inside the reactor 4 are far more long-lasting than anyone had believed. So on May 16, the governmental task force issued a new order. Instead of drills, there had to be built a long tunnel ending with a chamber 30 to 30 meters or 100 to 100 feet. In that chamber had to be installed heat exchangers and control equipment, so this would cool the reactor more effectively. The design and installation were assigned to the Ministry of Middle Machine Building, led by Yefim Slavsky, while the actual digging was to be done by miners from the Ministry of Coal, led by Mikhail Shadov. And here it will be fair to give an important remark. In one very well-known miniseries, Minister Shadow was portrayed like this, which is very far from truth. The real Mikhail Shadow started to work in a coal mine at the age of 15 and passed all the hard way before becoming All-Union Minister. Not only he had the highest respect among miners, but went himself to the disaster zone to manage his people. And that said, it is hardly possible that any of miners would ever treat him like this. Most of miners came from east of Ukraine, some also came from Tula region of Russia, and in front of them was a big work. The tunnel had to be 136 meters or 446 feet long. But as they were running out of time to pass this distance faster, miners suggested to make it small, just 2 meters or 6.5 feet in diameter. Because it was passing under the heavy structures and in sand, it couldn't be made with the techniques used in coal mines. And instead, it was assembled from so-called tubings, a concrete segment similar to those used in subway construction. But when you add to this rails for mining carts, vans and cables, the remaining space was really tight, less than 6 feet. That meant that practically all work had to be done manually. Vladimir Dmitriev, one of the high engineers of sarcophagus construction, later recalled, "The miners worked in shifts without any breaks. Using shovels and jackhammers they advanced, pouring the sand into carts which were immediately pushed to the exit. Because of that, radiation inside the tunnel itself was absolutely normal. But it was incredibly hot, up to 60 degrees Celsius or 140 Fahrenheit. This is because there was a lot of welding works ongoing as well, and vents simply could not manage it. So people were removing half of their clothes, and respirators immediately filled with moisture, basically becoming useless. Everyone drank incredible amount of water, but it was instantly sweated out. The tunnel ended with a chamber right under the reactor, with the old foundation as its ceiling. So the sand here had to be removed very slowly and in small portions to prevent possible collapse. And one day during this operation, suddenly from the ceiling came a very loud cracking sound, followed by falling sand. For a moment, it felt that foundation of Unit 4 cracked and the chamber was about to turn into a mass grave. Everyone stopped frozen, exchanging these disturbed looks in absolute silence. Up to present day, no one knows what exactly happened, but luckily it didn't develop further. So eventually the work continued and the chamber was built. At the same time, while miners were digging, engineers of Ministry of Metal Machine Building prepared elements of the heat exchanger. Each consisted of tightly arranged pipes and had a size which could make them pass through that narrow tunnel. But even like this, they were half a ton heavy. In the chamber was made a new concrete foundation and powerful metal supports. Then the segments were manually moved into the chamber and positioned inside. They were outlined with graphite panels and covered with ground graphite to provide a proper heat distribution. After all that, all this was connected with pipes, and finally around were created extra supports delivering weight to the new foundation. So it looks like that according to the initial idea, to keep it all serviceable, the tunnel and the chamber had to remain accessible. However, there came a discovery. From our previous episode about buoys, you may remember a story of Oleg Garashenko from Kyiv Institute of Technical Thermal Physics. If you didn't watch it, we'll give you the main idea. So his team created special thermal flux detectors. As the chamber finally allowed to reach the reactor from the bottom, a large network of such detectors was installed inside. And it proved there was no risk of further meltdown. In other words, the heat exchanger was no longer needed. Despite this, just in case, the system was tested and on June 24, less than 2 months after the disaster, the job was done. Later, when even more accurate information was obtained, a decision came to fill the chamber and the tunnel with concrete. Effectively, it turned it into one more powerful barrier between the reactor and water horizons. What is said, however, that Soviet media and propaganda focused only on the miners' heroism, completely neglecting the critical contributions of the assembly engineers and metro builders. All these people did their best to complete this complex operation, and many of them left their house in Chernobyl. It is not possible to put everything in one episode, so more detailed stories about this project you'll be able to find on our Patreon page. There is more than 500,000 posts, each offering an insight into Chernobyl as a phenomenon, often close and personal. This episode is a part of a series, so check out our other documentaries because we have many interesting things to share. Thank you for watching and see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.